One. Hello, everyone, everywhere. Pastor Bob Thibodeau here. Welcome to the Kingdom Crossroads podcast today. We're so blessed that you're joining us. You know, as Christians, we've heard the continuous arguments back and forth about a day of rest. Another term used is a Sabbath of rest. The arguments form around if that is simply an Old Testament tradition that is no longer applicable for this modern age, or are Saturdays the day that needs to be recognized, or Sunday is the day true Christians should observe because it's the recognition of the resurrection of Christ? You know, the divides are deep on this topic, and they've resulted in some denominational splits. These arguments have split families. These arguments have affected people's employment opportunities as well. To help us understand the true biblical concept of rest, as our guest today, Gregory Hall. Now, Greg was a pastor for 10 years. He served as an adjunct professor for a few local universities where he lives up in the Northwest U.S. He has a podcast called Rethinking Scripture and is the author of a great book, Rethinking Rest, Why Our Approach to Sabbath Isn't Working. I'm looking forward to this interview as I believe it will open our eyes to what the Bible truly has to say about this topic. Help me welcome to the program, Gregory Hall. Greg, it is so good to have you on the program today, and I appreciate your willingness to come on the show and discuss this important and sometimes confusing and controversial topic with us.
Well, thank you very much. I am excited to be here, and let's talk about rest. I agree.
Amen. Well, the first question I always start with is this. Other than that brief information I just shared, can you tell us in your own words, who is Gregory Hall?
Yeah. So I am, first and foremost, I like to start out by just saying I'm a family guy. I've been married 32 years. I married my high school sweetheart.
Amen.
And just last December hit number 32. We have two sons. They're in their mid-20s. They've both graduated from college. So my job is done as a parent, right?
Amen.
And we live in the Pacific Northwest in the United States, Salem, Oregon, and we are lucky enough to live on 5 acres, and I've got a little tractor that I like playing around on, although I'm not necessarily a farmer. So let's get that out there right there.
I have visions of, you know, green acres, you know.
Yeah, no, that's probably right. I'm riding my tractor in my suit. Yeah. And yeah, so I used to be a lot of things. I used to be an athlete when I was coming out of high school and into college. But I had several knee surgeries in my 20s. And so that just forced me to take a look at, you know, different opportunities. And so I swim 4 to 5 days a week now. That's the thing that keeps me, that puts me to bed at night. I don't know what it is for other people, but if I don't get my swim in, I get a little restless. So,
Yeah, that's good exercise. That's for
oh,
sure.
It's a killer. Yeah. I swam last year. I actually went back in December and kept track. I swam 244 miles last year.
Wow.
Amen. So, amen. Yeah, that's 4 to 5 days a week of just, getting after. That's my thinking time, though, actually.
True.
When I get in the water, it's the one time in my life that nobody can disturb me.
I can understand that fully. When I was, before I got injured in as a police officer, I was into running, marathons and all that stuff, you know, just from my military days. And I got like a 50,000 mile running certificate or something around, you know, that I got from the military before. But that was my alone time, you know, where I did all my thinking, you know, and just get out on the roads. Nobody's bothering you. Just go for it. And I used to put in sometimes 14, 15 miles a day. Just, you know, I get done cutting the grass on the weekends. Nothing to do. I'm going for a run. I go out 10 miles, come back.
You
know?
Wow.
So I can understand what you're talking about with the swimming.
Yeah.
I tried the swimming. And I kept sinking.
Yeah, that's a problem. That's a problem. So
it will wear you out.
Yep. And the latest change I've made in my life is I've switched to half calf in the morning. So instead of that full calf, it gets me a little jittery if I go the full stuff. So.
Yeah, well, that one I'm in the opposite direction. I have what's called Bob's Brew.
Oh, okay.
I mix like four different things and into what I call coffee. My wife calls it medicine, but I call it coffee.
That's good.
So, that's good. Anyway, in your book, Rethinking Rest, Why Our Approach to Sabbath Isn't Working, you make a distinction between rest and Sabbath. Can you explain that for us?
Yeah. So most of the time when I start talking about this in front of a group or something, I'll just ask the question, when I say biblical rest, because I say my book is a theology of biblical rest, I ask the question, when I say biblical rest, what comes to mind? And, you know, people will come up with different things from either Old Testament or New Testament, but usually the conversation will venture into what they call the Sabbath. And when they start talking about Sabbath is actually the fourth commandment, the seventh day Sabbath. So what's interesting, though, is when we go back into the Bible and we look at the whole theology of rest, because it starts, you know, in Genesis chapter 1 and 2 with the creation account. It goes all the way through to the book of Revelation in the new heavens and the new earth. So they're kind of bookends on a cosmos at rest under God's authority, right? And then we get these pictures of rest in the middle of something that was lost and something that will be regained. But we get these pictures of rest, and the fourth commandment is just one of many pictures that we have in the Bible. So the difference between biblical rest and a Sabbath is really all Sabbath is a ceasing. That's kind of the Hebrew meaning of the word, is to cease. And we assume that it's the definition given in the fourth commandment, you know, cease work one day a week. That's what the fourth commandment talked about. But in reality, I think when we hear Jesus talking about it, and we hear the author of Hebrews talking about it, we're talking about the bigger topic of biblical rest. And that just brings up the question, well, what does ceasing have to do if it doesn't mean stop work one day a week? And so therein lies the conversation that usually gets started when I talk to groups.
Okay. Amen. Amen. And, you know, we know some denominations that follow the tradition, you know, that Saturday is the biblical day of the Sabbath, right? And we also have many Christian denominations in particular that recognize Sunday as the Sabbath day, because that's the day of the week Jesus rose from the dead. And I guess I have two questions on this point. Does it matter, as long as we're recognizing a day of rest as a Sabbath? And if it does matter, which day is correct?
Oh, well, just put me on the spot early here. That's good. I like that.
Because I'll sit back, take a sip of coffee now.
Stir the pot a little bit. That's nice. Yeah. So does it matter? Well, of course it matters, because anything that's important to God, you know, should matter to us, even if we don't realize it, right? So the question, though, that you asked, is it Saturday or Sunday, I think may have a fallacy in it. And no problem with you there. It's just a fallacy that we have in our culture. And because when we start talking about Sabbath, we assume, like I said earlier, we assume that the seventh day Sabbath, or a one day a week observance, however we view that, we assume that that's kind of the crown jewel of what's available right now. And so to ask, is it Saturday or Sunday? Well, those aren't even the options, because, you know, you've pointed out Saturday, Old Testament Sabbath, right? Friday night sundown to Saturday night sundown would be the typical way that is viewed. And then some people in the New Testament, some people today notice that in the New Testament, people are gathering on Sunday. That's the day of the Lord's resurrection, as you mentioned. So there's a whole theology that says that maybe the Sabbath moved to Sunday for New Testament people. But then there was a guy named Martin Luther that came around in the 1500s, and he realized that there were more than one or two people that had to work on Sunday. The pastors being one of them, by the way, right?
Yep, that was my next question.
Yeah. So Luther introduced the idea, you know, if your schedule doesn't allow you to observe Sabbath on Sunday, you could move that to another day of the week. And then eventually that morphed into, in our American freedom, you know, democracy moving across the world. That moved into, you know what, I'm kind of more in control of this Sabbath idea, so I can piecemeal it even if I got 3 hours on Monday afternoon, maybe 4 hours on Thursday, and then maybe Saturday morning. That's my Sabbath. And so people have been not being able to land on a definition of what the Sabbath is, the seventh day Sabbath. And what that has done, it has caused a theological cul-de-sac, is what I call it, because we get into conversations about what the Sabbath is, and we can't even decide what an equal definition of the term is. I mean, we get so caught up in trying to define what the seventh day Sabbath concept is that we never get past that concept to the bigger, larger theology of rest, right, that the Bible offers. And I think it's those conversations. So even in your question, right, is it Saturday or Sunday? That's typical what I would get
from That's people. Why I threw it out there at first.
Yeah, it's typical of what people want to know. They want to know, is it Saturday or Sunday? Or can I have it another day of the week? Or can I piecemeal it? And I just sort of back away from that question. And I said, well, we're talking in that question, we're talking about the seventh day Sabbath. That's the fourth commandment. But that's not all about what the Bible has to say about Sabbath. And in reality, where my book lands, I'll just get it out there early here, where my book lands is the seventh day Sabbath was only always supposed to be a reminder of a larger Sabbath idea. And so when people practiced the seventh day Sabbath, the fourth commandment out of the Ten Commandments, what was supposed to happen was they were supposed to be remembering something larger than just that. And the problem is we've made the fourth commandment into something in and of itself. And so when we practice a fourth commandment one day a week or any variation of that, we tend to think that we are fulfilling the idea of Sabbath. And that's not at all what the Bible has to say about it.
Amen. And a question that comes up frequently is this. You know, in Genesis, we see that God rested, as you said, on the seventh day. Some people ask, well, if God's all powerful, why did he need to rest? Okay. Exactly. In your book, you share a different perspective on that view. Share that with us.
Yeah. So there's a biblical scholar out there at Wheaton College in the United States, and his name is John Walton, and he's written several books. He's a well-respected Old Testament scholar. And one of the things he's brought to the table, better, I think, than most other Old Testament scholars, is he's gone into the extra-biblical sources of the same time period and culture as the Bible. And in those extra-biblical sources, what he's found is creation accounts written by pagan sources about pagan gods. So it's not the biblical account at all. But some of those stories have similarities. And one of the similarities is at the end of the creation account in the pagan stories, the victorious god, because there was a battle, because there's more than one god, they have to battle to decide who creates the universe and the cosmos. The one that won builds a temple. He places his image within the temple, and then he rests. It actually says he rests. But in that context, what John Walton found out is that when it says in a pagan source that the god rests, it's not taking a day off. It's actually talking about sitting down on the throne and actually beginning his rule. So in a modern example would be, let's say in a football coach at a college, the football coach gets hired. He's got a lot of things to do before the season starts. Sometimes he hires coaches and recruits players and orders equipment. These are all formation things. But once the actual season starts and he gets out on the field, that's kind of the ruling of the football coach. I mean, everything else is preparatory. And so you've got this preparatory idea and then this, I'm in charge and I'm running the show. And that's what rest is in an ancient Near Eastern context. And so what Walton has done, to get to your question, so what Walton has done is come back into the Bible, because he's a Bible scholar. He's taken that information from a similar ancient culture, similar idea of, you know, setting up a cosmos and things like that. And he sees the similarities that the biblical story has, which makes sense because it would have been written to people so they could understand it in that time period. But then he says, oh, it's interesting that in the biblical story, God rests on the seventh day. And we've always assumed, not having extra biblical help in this area, we've always assumed, like you said, that God's taken a day off. And that just prompts the obvious questions. Why is God taking a day off? He's all powerful. He doesn't need a break. And all those are true. And so the idea of God resting as, and if we define it as a physical rest, that just never really made sense theologically. And the best that we've come up with that I've been able to find is that people say that God is modeling for humanity what he wants humanity to do, which just gets back to the idea that really one day a week is the end all, the crown jewel. And that's, again, missing the point. If God's rest on day seven is not taking a break, is not taking a day off, but is really him ceasing one activity, the organization of the cosmos that he did on days one through six. And he ceases that activity, but he begins another activity. And if that activity is actually the ruling of the cosmos, if that's the way we're supposed to understand it, well, that really gives a different definition to the idea of rest, because we've gone one direction with rest, and the Bible may be trying to take us a different direction. And so hence the name of my book, Rethinking Rest, right?
Yeah. Amen. Cause I want to hold that thought and then come back and hit it from another direction.
Yeah. You
know, we talked about a few minutes ago about, you know, professions at work on Sunday or on Saturday. You know, I was in the military, also in law enforcement. We were required to work rotating schedules that included working, you know, rotating weekends.
Yeah.
And, you know, sometimes we're off, sometimes we're on. Hospitals and other professions do the same thing. And what you're saying is that the biblical day of rest and the Sabbath isn't what we were taught it meant, but just that we were to be part of our routine. I mean, as long as we are resting at some point, you know, they're not really in sin working on a work schedule.
Yeah.
If that's what their employment is requiring, right?
Yeah. Yeah. Well, yeah. So let's back away from the topic a little bit even more, because I think as Jesus does with a lot of topics, he turns everything upside down. I mean, it's often described as an upside down kingdom, Jesus's kingdom, right?
Yeah.
I like to think of it the other way. I think Jesus's kingdom is the right side up one. And I'd like to think the one we're under is the upside down kingdom. So it is opposite of what we're used to. And Jesus does that often, you know, the last shall be first. Ideas like that wouldn't just naturally work in the world that we go out and work in. Mm-hmm. And I think he's done this with rest as well. I think the fourth commandment was certainly taking a day off from physical labor. I mean, but that was just a shadow of something bigger. He did this with other commandments. People understand this as soon as I start talking about it. When Jesus started talking about the Ten Commandments, he picked a few out, right? And he said, like, for adultery, it's not just the physical act of adultery that the Old Testament concept was really pointing to. So if you're hyper-focused on the outward behavior that the commandment prohibits, then you're missing the deeper point. And Jesus said, it's really about lust in the inward part of a person. That's what we want. Because the outward behavior is just a manifestation, right? It's just,
right. Yeah.
It's not the deeper problem. Yeah. So he did it with murder as well, right? Mm-hmm. If you're only concerned about actually physically murdering somebody, that you're missing the whole point of the original commandment, not just the way Jesus retaught it. He said the original commandment wasn't about that either. It was about the inner condition of, you know, the hatred that we have within our soul that leads to somebody committing that act.
Amen.
And so why would it be a surprise if we got to the fourth commandment about Sabbath and find that he did a very similar thing? I mean, he took this idea of physical rest one day a week, and throughout the Gospels, Jesus is talking about this idea of, you know what, this is not just about not doing work. You're missing the point, and especially one day a week. Mm-hmm. Because if rest, let's think about this. Most people think the opposite of rest is work. Okay, that sounds basic, I know.
that's true, though.
Yeah. So if I was to ask a crowd, what's the opposite of rest? Typical response would be
work.
Yeah. Well, when I'm working, I'm not at rest. Let's start thinking about rest in a different context. Let's start thinking about it as a soul condition instead of a physical activity, right? Mm-hmm. And when we do that, we begin to see that the opposite of rest is restlessness, which is a soul condition that Jesus wants to cure. And then the next obvious question is, what makes us restless? Well, I'm going to argue, and I do in my book, I'm going to argue that we are restless when we're not where we're supposed to be in life, doing the thing that we're supposed to be doing.
Amen.
Right?
Amen.
And a lot of people find themselves in that condition. It's just it's a common occurrence out. I call it the curse a day world. That world that we have to go out into and live in and function in, we go out there and a lot of us are just caught doing something on a regular basis, oftentimes from, you know, our job, for money, that we're just not called to, that doesn't click all the switches, right, in our life. Doesn't wake us up in the morning excited. And so when we think about rest, what I want to start thinking is how do I get my soul at rest? Because when I listen to what Jesus had to say, when I read about what the author of Hebrews wrote about the topic in chapters 3 and 4, what we're talking about is not physical cessation of labor, of physical labor. What we're talking about is how do we get our souls to a point where they are at rest? And the interesting thing is, I can be doing my work and I can be at rest. And that's the flip of the script that Jesus did. So really the question of, is it a weekend activity? Should I take one day a week off? Should I feel guilty if I'm having to work on Sunday? I think we're asking the wrong question. I mean, I think we're approaching it from a fourth commandment standpoint, right, which is a cul-de-sac, which gets us caught and we miss the bigger theology of that Jesus was trying to point us to.
Amen. So using that concept then, we'll use what we just talked about briefly before, you know, I was into running, you're into swimming, you know, if that allows us that mental break, you know, mentally resting, or maybe even things like cutting the grass or, you know, doing little chores around the house, if that gives us peace, would that be considered rest?
If that's what God's calling you to do in your station of life. Here's how I think about it. Each of us, and in the one of the last chapters, I talk about each of us has been given gifts and talents. I mean, this is not new information. We've been gifted by the Holy Spirit. The things that you do well, I don't do well. I'm a toe, you're a hand, somebody else is, you know, the arm, the legs. We're the body of Christ. We've all been gifted in different ways. And when God asks us to enter into life under his rule and authority, what he's asking us to do is follow his guidance for the gifts and talents that he's already given us. And so he'll place us, he'll put us in a place at any given time in our life, and he'll ask us to use our gifts and talents. And I call those sweet spots. And that's just this idea of, you know, when I'm doing something and I get done doing that, I know I'm exactly where I was supposed to be right then.
Yeah. Amen.
I get that confirmation through either through the Holy Spirit or just my own sense of accomplishment, because I know I'm good at something that I do. And that's not a vain thing. That's not me trying to puff myself up. That's just like, hey, I've been gifted to do this thing. And when I do it, I get a sense I do it well, because I get feedback, because the outcomes are good. When I'm in that spot, when I'm able to do what I've been gifted to do, and I know that this is where God would have me at any given moment, that is a state of rest. Yeah. So let's go back to the beginning of the story. You've got the initial creation account, right? In Genesis 1, the first 6 days are right there in the first chapter. And then the beginning of chapter 2 is day 7, where God rests. And then that first biblical account of creation ends, and a second one starts, and a lot of debate on how we should read those. But the second one is the story of Adam and Eve. And essentially, theologians have agreed that the Garden of Eden is the first temple. It's not a structure the way we would identify a temple, but it's the special place of God's presence, which is what a temple is, right? Mm-hmm. And so Garden of Eden, God builds a temple. He places his image, humanity, within it, Adam and Eve. And they are at rest with God. The Hebrew actually says that God rested them. He rested them in the garden. Mm-hmm. He put Adam in the garden and he rested them. Meaning, Adam, I'm giving you a place to be. I'm giving you something to do, subdue and rule. Subdue and rule. Multiply, right? Cultivate and keep. Those are all things God gave to Adam to do. I've given you a place to be and a thing to do. And when you're in your place, Adam and Eve, and doing the thing I've given you to do, you'll be at rest with me because you're sharing in my rule of this thing that I've created. Remember, when God is at rest, he is ruling.
Yeah,
and he shares that rule with humanity. So when we fall under his precepts, the way he would have us do it, and we live life that way, and we find ourselves in the place that we are supposed to be, that's when we're at rest. And it's, again, it's not talking about physical, it's talking about the soul. Our soul is at rest because we know we're exactly where we're supposed to be, and we're doing the thing that we're supposed to be doing.
And there's and that, oh, go ahead.
No, I was just going to say, there's nothing better than that in life when that actually happens. If that could be 24/7, we would be experiencing Sabbath all the time. And I think that's what the hereafter is, right?
Yeah. Yeah. Amen. I know at the end of your book, you have a very unique section that I found amazingly interesting, and it made me think, because you asked the question, what did God do on the eighth day?
Yeah.
Can you share that with us?
Yeah. So we get some context. Most people would say, what? If we understand rest is taking a break, taking time off of work, we would assume that God goes back to work on the eighth day, because that's what we do if we're observing a fourth commandment, seventh day Sabbath. We take one day off and then we head back to work. And in Hebrew time, that's Saturday nights are coming. But in most modern contexts, that's Mondays are coming, right? We wake up Monday morning, we have to go back to work. We assume that's what's happening to God in chapter 2 of the Bible. But there are some context clues in that first chapter that would suggest otherwise. There's, I used to teach English. It was junior high English, so it really didn't count. But in English, when you study literature, you notice repetition that authors often use. And they use repetition within writing for a reason. They get you further down the road. And then usually what they do is they break from that repetition to make a point. And that happens twice in Genesis chapter 1. And this will become obvious as soon as I start talking about it. God calls things good in the biblical creation account. He does it several times. And it was good, it was good, it was good. And then at the very end, he changes that repetition to very good, right? When everything's done. Good in the biblical account just means it's in its place. It's working correctly. It's functioning the way it's supposed to function. Okay. The other literary device that's very important is the switching from days. And the repetition is there was evening, there was morning the first day. There was evening, morning. He does it for the first 6 days. There was evening, there was morning, day 6. But then when he gets to day 7, and that's the way you switch from one day to another, right? When he gets to day 7, if you go to Genesis chapter 2, verses 1 through 3, or 1 through 4, there's no evening, morning motif on day 7.
Right.
And most people just don't even notice it. But having studied literature, I looked at that and I thought, that's a significant thing. And I often ask this, do you think that the author, having used it 6 times for the first 6 days, just happened to forget to include it on day 7?
Yeah.
And most people say, no, that's ridiculous. Well, yeah. If you have a high view of scripture, which you should, that's impossible anyway. Nobody just forgets to include something if God's finger is on it. So
yeah.
The absence of an evening morning motif on day 7 is there for a reason. And literarily speaking, what that means is there was no exit out of day 7. In other words, day 7 never ended.
Still
because
is.
There was no evening morning motif. And most people start raising their hands at this point. Are you saying we're still in day 7? Well, there's a difference between literarily speaking and literally speaking, right? So if the question is literally, did day 7 end? The obvious question or the obvious answer is yes, day 7 ended. I woke up this morning. It wasn't yesterday, today. So we know that. Okay. But literarily, when we ask the question, did day 7 end? Maybe more importantly, let's phrase it this way. Literarily speaking, did the theological events that happened in day 7 ever end? And the author of the biblical account is asking us to view that as, no, they didn't end, because I didn't include the evening morning motif for day 7. So whatever it is that God went into his rest on day 7, that's exactly what he was doing on day 8 and day 9 and day 10 and all the way to this morning when we're recording Amen. This interview. And that doesn't make sense if God's taken a day off from physical work. That doesn't make sense at all. But if we understand God's rest as the beginning of his rule, kind of like in the United States, we have a president. When the president sits down in the Oval Office, he's there to rule. He's not taking time off in that space. When God sits on his throne, he is there to rule, and that is resting for God, the God of the universe. And that's what began on day 7. And I'm suggesting, and many other people have done this, so this isn't something I came up with by myself. Many other people, theologians, are recognizing that the theological events of day 7 were the beginning of his rule, that he never left.
Amen.
Yeah.
Amen. I see also in your book where you discuss Plato and his description of shadows. right?
Yeah.
That caught my attention because I recently did a teaching on types and shadows that Moses was told to, you know, pattern the elements of the tabernacle after. And a shadow, basically, a shadow has no substance. It is only an indicator that there is something of substance behind the shadow, right? And the Sabbath is mentioned as one of those shadows.
Yeah.
How should we interpret those references concerning the commandment to observe the Sabbath day if, as we just got done explaining, it's a shadow of God ruling right now?
Yeah. Good question. So what do we do with the Ten Commandments? What do we do with the Old Testament law? I mean, that's a huge question, obviously, and not going to be able to do it complete justice here. But it is interesting, like you said, that the New Testament authors, in a couple different places, in the book of Hebrews and Colossians, the New Testament authors refer to the Old Testament law as a shadow. And I bring in the idea, like you mentioned, of Plato's idea of the shadow world, right? Being a reflection of, he has an allegory of the cave that he wrote about in the Republic. It's very well known. People can look it up. And that happened, Plato was beginning his discussion in the intertestamental period. So after the Old Testament was done being written, there's a period of hundreds of years in between the two testaments. And that's when Plato actually started writing and his ideas began to develop and then went on to Aristotle and those that followed. So when Jesus comes on the scene and the New Testament authors come on the scene, they come into a Hellenized Greek philosophic world that talking about shadows would have been second nature. People would have understood what a shadow was from a Platonic sense, not just, you know, going out on a sunny day and looking at your shadow. But the concept is very similar. Like you said, shadows don't have substance. They're flat, one-dimensional objects. They portray a little bit about the substance that casts them, but they can never be the substance themselves. And so what the New Testament tells us about shadows, number one, the Old Testament law in its entirety is a law of shadows. It's only there dimly representing whatever it is that casts that shadow. And it just says the substance of that shadow is Christ. I mean, Jesus is the shadow caster. And so when we're looking at Old Testament shadows, what we're seeing is a dim reflection of a larger truth. And those shadows were always supposed to get us to that larger truth. In Old Testament times, it's all they had. They had an expectation of a Messiah to come. And so they were expectantly looking forward. That's what the law was supposed to do, have them expectantly looking forward to a time when Messiah would come. But here in the New Testament times, having had Jesus come and do his work, if we're still spending all of our focus on an Old Testament shadow when the shadow caster has arrived, I think we're missing the point of why that Old Testament covenant was made in the first place.
Yeah.
I think, and again, I feel like I'm stepping on toes because depending on the denomination or the tradition that you may have grown up in, or, you know, a church tradition, you're going to have very specific views likely on how we treat the Old Testament. And it may be different than what I just said. And that's okay. It's good to disagree. It's good to stretch people. And I'm not saying you need to buy wholeheartedly into what I have to say about this topic.
Yeah.
But I think oftentimes we get pigeonholed on an idea and we grasp it, and it's really hard to let go of something, even if some of the New Testament authors point directly to it and say, that's a shadow ministry and Jesus is the substance. Yeah.
I know in chapter 7 of your book, you discuss testing the waters of rest. Explain that for us and how we can go through the process of testing the waters of rest.
Yeah, so I go back to my swimming analogies in the book there, because I love swimming. Like I said earlier, I love swimming laps, the peace and solitude that's available there, plus the physical workout. But there's one thing I absolutely hate about swimming, and that's getting in the water, because I hate getting into cold water. It is the absolute worst part of the whole event. And so I've developed, when I go swimming, I've developed this long drawn out process of getting in the water to make it a little more palatable. I sit down on the edge of the pool. I put one foot in. I very gently put a second foot in. I start splashing myself. I pretend like I'm stretching just to give myself more time to get used to it. But eventually what happens, 9 times out of 10, because there's that rare occasion I just get up and go home. No, 9 times out of 10, I'll eventually, you know, start my watch, tell my watch I'm about to start an activity, and I'll hop in. But that process of testing the waters that I do when I go swimming, very similar, I think, to what we should be doing when we're testing the waters of rest. So what do I mean by the waters of rest? God's given us gifts and talents, like I said earlier. He's called us to certain places, but the problem is those places shift throughout life. So I was an athlete when I was in college, but as soon as college ended, I tore my ACL, had some other knee problems, and my athletic career just ended. But that was a big part of my life for several years in that period of my life. But when that shifted, God called me somewhere else. And that was teaching junior high English. I can't believe I'm actually saying that. God can call people to teach junior high English. And when I was there, when I was teaching those classes, I knew I was exactly where I was supposed to be. God confirmed it in my soul, confirmed it by the response of other people. And I was in a new sweet spot. I had pivoted to a new sweet spot. And then some circumstances changed, and my wife and I moved back to the town that we grew up in, and I started selling real estate, kind of an odd switch. And it took about a year, but after about a year, God confirmed, this is exactly, I tell the story in my book, this is exactly where you're supposed to be.
Amen.
And that lasted for 17, 18 years until the real estate market just in 08 went crazy.
Yeah.
And that's, I felt God saying, you know what? I've got another place for you to be. And I said, well, where is it? I have no idea. And he said, you know what? You've gotten a master's in theology by that point. I'm going to have you be a pastor. And he called me to a youth ministry that I was gifted to do. And I was called to do. And when I was there, no question, it's exactly where I was supposed to be. So we have these sweet spots.
Yeah.
And they're not constant. And I think what the problem a lot of people get into is that they get this idea that, oh, this is what I'm good at, and this is all I'm ever going to be good at. And so I'm just going to double down and keep doing that. And sometimes they ignore the obvious calling of God in their life, whether it's through circumstances or confirmation through a prayer life or reading scripture or however it is that God talks to you. Sometimes we ignore the idea that God is calling me out of where, out of a sweet spot that I've had for a while. And he's got something new for me, because that's scary. That's intimidating. That's, that's not my idea. Right. And when it's not my idea, then why should I do that?
Yeah, human nature is, you know, I'm here, it's working well. This is where I want to be. This is where I want to stay. And when God says, I want you to go here. No.
Exactly.
Cause I learned that, you know, we didn't go into that when I was in Texas and had my business and all that. It was going well. I could see things on the horizon, and you know, my daughter had married someone, had moved to the East Coast. And she goes, Dad, you need to come out here because, you know, there's a lot of stuff going on out here. Well, I said, nope, I'm staying right here in Texas is God's country. And this is where I'm going to be, you know, type thing. And yeah. But inside, I seen God opening these doors. I said, no, I don't want to, you know. And then all of a sudden, the business started going downhill rapidly. It got to the point where, well, okay, we'll go out there. And as soon as I got here, the blessing was here, you know. Yep. And we get into that where, you know, testing the waters, right?
Yeah.
I didn't want to test the water. I was happy here, you know.
Yep.
And God was, I mean, it was just so obvious looking back, the signs, you know. I mean, I use the allegory of Elijah, you know, going up to talk to the king, saying, it won't rain till I say so. See ya. Right.
Yeah.
And the king's like, who's that guy?
Yeah.
And then, you know, God didn't pat him on the back, say, good job, Elijah. Go kick back and take it easy. No, he said, run, boy. You know? He's like, exactly. go out there. Yep. And Elijah could have fought. He said, No, I don't want to go out and live out in the woods by a creek. Oh, I got a nice house. I got friends, you know, I'm going to stay here. And he could have done that. He could have stayed right there in town and then been arrested and hung and all this other stuff. But he obeyed. He ran.
Yep.
And God took care of him. And I had to learn that lesson the hard way, right?
Yeah.
That when God says go, you say, yes, sir, here we go.
Well, it's the story of Abraham too, right?
Oh, yeah.
Abraham, God says, I've got a place for you. I've got a new place. And Abraham could have said, no, I kind of like where I'm at.
Yeah.
He said, no, I'm interested in finding that land that you're about to show me. I have no idea where it is, but let's go, right?
Yeah.
And so we've talked about one response to testing the waters when God calls us is to be like, I don't want to go there because I'm comfortable where I'm at. The other flip side of that is another danger of not testing the waters is just whenever we sense God might be calling us, to just jump fully in 100% at the get-go.
Yeah.
I would never do that swimming myself because, that would be awful. That ruined the rest of my day swimming. But what tends to happen is we think we hear God's call and then we'll just say yes to everything in that direction. And then we find ourselves sometimes with commitments in a place where it's like, ooh, this is not a good fit, right? Yeah. We can do that with a job, with a ministry. We can do that with a lot of different things, relationships, when we think God's leading us in a certain direction.
Yep.
So this idea of testing the waters of rest, it's just this intentional time where you're spending time listening to God, listening for his voice. What has he put across my plate the last few days or weeks or months? What is he prompting me towards? And am I willing to go dip my toe in those waters and see if it's a good fit? Number one, see if it's a good fit. Because oftentimes, and this happens to everybody, God's called me to something and I think it's there. So I go dip my toe in there and quickly it's just like, well, that's not it. It's clear that's for whatever reason, that's not it. But interestingly enough, what I learned while I was dipping my toe in is that, I could be really good at that. And that was really fun, maybe in a different setting. So, right there, because somebody called me last week and over here, there's another opportunity and that is a perfect fit.
Yeah,
I would have never responded to that phone call from a week ago had I not dipped my toe in the water over here where it wasn't a good fit. So that testing the waters is kind of like picking your lane. If you're swimming, right? Just being willing to ask the question, what kind of conversations has God brought into my life? Who's speaking? What opportunities are available? Am I at peace? Am I at rest where I'm at? If I'm not, maybe God's have circumstances changed recently? All of those factors go into where might God be calling me to a new sweet spot. One of the things Jesus says, we haven't talked a lot about Jesus and that's unfortunate. No. One of the things he says, very famous Matthew 11, 28 through 30. Come to me, all you who are weary and heavy laden, and I will give you one day a week off. No, he doesn't say that. He backs away from the fourth commandment.
Yeah. Amen.
He isn't talking about the fourth commandment where we often go. He's talking about rest, and it's soul rest, because later he says, take my yoke upon you and I will give you rest for your soul. Amen. So we know where Jesus is headed, what his end goal is. And it's not having to do with a regulation or making you feel guilty about what you do one day a week.
Amen.
It's about being fulfilled every day of the week. And the interesting thing that most people don't understand, and I only do because I've researched it, is this idea of a yoke.
Yep.
Because he connects his offer of rest to taking his yoke upon us, which is weird because a yoke is an instrument of work. It's that piece of wood that goes across two pole animals, work animals, like two oxen, that connects them together, that you put reins to, and somebody holds the reins and directs the work that the two oxen do. And when Jesus gives us an offer of rest, he is saying the way you find rest for your soul is allow me to guide what work you do. And that is flipping the script on the way I used to look at this topic. Because I thought it was all about taking one day a week off.
Amen.
And now my focus is really on, am I allowing Jesus to guide me to the work that he's called me to do, to find my place to be and my thing to do? Am I allowing that, or am I trying to take control of that process and guide my own life to my own purposes and places? That's what Adam and Eve did, right? God had given them direction. They decided, you know, I don't really like the way you've set up the cosmos.
Yeah.
I want to be in a different position, so I'm going to take this fruit and partake of it. And God says, that's fine. That's your right. Humanity has that right. You can go your own way. But the consequence is you will be removed from my rest, my rule. And Adam and Eve are sent out of the garden where their rest was, because they were ruling with God. They're doing the same work out in the cursed day world, but now it's painful.
Yeah. So true.
And it's not just physical pain. We get caught up in the physical pain of like childbirth. And I get that childbirth is painful. I'm not trying to downplay that. But the real pain out there in the world that Adam and Eve experienced wasn't physical pain. It was soul pain. It was the pain that Eve and Adam understood when she got pregnant for the first time. And they now realized that that son that was going to be born would eventually die.
Yeah.
And it could have lived forever.
Amen. Amen.
That's the soul pain we all deal with on a daily basis out in the cursed day world.
Amen. Well, Greg, as I said, this has really been interesting. How can someone order a copy of your book, Rethinking Rest, Why Our Approach to Sabbath Isn't Working? Is it on Amazon?
Yeah, it's on Amazon. It's on Barnes & Noble. Just Google it. It'll be out there. You can find it. Yeah.
Amen. And if someone wanted to reach out to you to ask a question, maybe do an interview like this, how can they do that? How can someone get in touch with you?
Yeah, so I've got two websites. One is my RethinkingScripture.com website. That's my podcast. And also RethinkingRest.com. That's my book website. And on both of those websites, I've got a contact tab at the top. You can just click on that. It sends me an email right away. And I would love to talk to anybody that wants to talk about rest. That's my gig.
Amen. Amen. Tell us about your podcast real quick.
Yeah. So I had this itch when I left my pastoral role where I got to teach a lot, right? About the Bible. I had this itch that needed to get scratched. And so I found that podcasting did that. So a lot of my podcasts is just walking through different books of the Bible. And I take a look at scriptures, usually from a thematic standpoint, from a literary standpoint. And try and give people a different perspective. It's called Rethinking Scripture. So I do the same thing with Scripture that I've done here with rest. Amen. I'm kind of saying, what are we missing when we go to Scripture? What's the thing that God wants us to see that we've been programmed to bypass right over? And we kind of dig into those and go down those rabbit holes.
Amen. Amen. I'll put a link to all this in the show notes below. Folks, unless you read books like Greg Hall's book, Rethinking Rest, Why Our Approach to Sabbath Isn't Working, you'll be stuck thinking like you always thunk. Now, with him being an English teacher, I guess I can say that may not be grammatically correct.
Get my red pen out right now.
But you get my point, right? You need to study the works from folks like Greg Hall and John Walton. He mentioned John Walton. You know, people who have taken the time to research and dig deep and then compile information in a manner that makes it easy for you, I, and others to comprehend and put to action. Amen. Go drop down in the show notes, order your copy of Greg Hall's great book, Rethinking Rest, Why Our Approach to Sabbath Isn't Working, right now. Do it while you're thinking about it. Don't let the devil give you, you know, get to take a chance to try and distract you and make you forget. Amen. Drop down the show notes, order your copy of Greg's book right now. While you're there, reach out to Greg. Check out his podcast. It is an interesting listen as well. Amen. Greg, again, I want to thank you for taking the time today to come on the program. I appreciate you joining us and enlighten us on the true rest that we should be seeking. I do appreciate it.
It's been a great time.
Amen. Folks, that is all the time we have for today. Oh, man, this is good. For Greg Hall and myself, this is Pastor Bob reminding you to be blessed in all that you do.